Nahara fil layl, that do you not see that Allah who merges the night into the day and merges the day into night, the merging aspect is yuliju, gradual. In Surah Az-Zumar, chapter 39, verse number 5, khalaqa samawati bil haq, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created the heavens with truth. Yukawiru layla ala nahare, yukawiru layla ala nahare, wa yukawiru nahara ala layl, that He coils the night over day and He coils the day over night. So coiling, for coiling, the word is recovery, meaning gradual. If the earth were flat, it would not be gradual. It would be sudden change of night and day. So it means the author knows that the earth is spherical, not flat. Who could have mentioned 1400 years ago? What the atheist will say? Now he will keep quiet. But you continue. You continue with all the scientific aspects, alhamdulillah, and you can see the video program of Dr. Zakir Naik, or scholars who have spoken on the subject, Quran and Modern Science, on YouTube. Inshallah, you must be having the video program. So in detail, you have that, alhamdulillah. So you can go on and on with this, speaking about astronomy, that, alhamdulillah, today scientist Edwin Hubble in 1925, he says that the universe is expanding. The universe is expanding. Quran mentions in Surah Zariyat, chapter 51, verse number 47, وَإِنْ خَلَقَ السَّمَوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ بِالْحَقِّ وَإِنَّا لَمُوسِعُونَ, that verily we are expanding it. وَالسَّمَاءَ بَنَيْنَاهَا بِأَيْدٍ, that we have created the heavens with our own hands. وَالسَّمَاءَ بَنَيْنَاهَا بِأَيْدٍ وَإِنَّا لَمُوسِعُونَ, verily we are expanding it. So how is it possible, this particular fact which is mentioned discovered in 1925, could have been mentioned 1400 years ago? Just impossible. Today we know that the smallest particle, there are smaller than atom. There are things smaller than atom. How is it possible 1400 years ago to know that the fact that there are things smaller than atom, when people till recent time it was known that atom is the smallest particle? In my school we were taught that atom is the smallest particle. Deedat, what was taught in your school? Atom is the smallest particle. Atom is the smallest particle. Then previously it was taught that atom is the smallest particle. Okay, previously. But in Surah Saba, chapter 34, verse number 1 and 2, وَقَالَ الَّذِينَ, that those who say لَا تَعْتِينَ سَا, that the hour will not come. Allah says that hour will definitely come from the one who is عَلِمِ الْغَيْبِ, لَا يَعْزِبُ عَنْهُ مِسْقَالَ ذَرَّ, from him the hid, anything that is hid, not equivalent to atom, is hidden from him. لَا يَعْزِبُ عَنْهُ مِسْقَالَ ذَرَّ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَلَا فِي الْأَرْضِ, whether it is in the heavens or in the earth, وَلَا يَعْزَبُ وَلَا أَصْغَرُ مِنْ ذَلِكَ, not even less than that, وَلَا أَكْبَرُ, not even more than that, إِلَّا فِي كَتَابِ مُبِينٍ, but it is mentioned in the book. So وَلَا أَصْغَرُ مِنْ ذَلِكَ, nothing less than that is significant here. Quran speaks about nothing less than the atom. How could Quran mention this fact 1400 years ago, which we come to know today? Today we know that there is electrons, protons, gamma, beta within the atom, which is subparticles of atom, but that time it was not known. So how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, how Quran could mention 1400 years ago, if it is not from Allah, how Quran could mention 1400 years ago that wala asghara min dhalika, nothing less than that. So nothing less than that indicates that the author knows that there are less than atom also. Quran mentions about the partition in the sea, Maraj al-Bahrain yaltaqiyan bainahuma barzakhul la yabghiyan, in Surah Al-Anbiya, Surah Al-Rahman, chapter 55, verse number 1920, that there are two flowing bodies of water, there is a barrier in between, never to be transgressed, never to be passed. So who speaks about this barrier, which we come to know today in this age, 1400 years back? Just impossible. Who can tell you about the family, animal life, bird life, Quran mentioned in Surah Anam chapter 6 verse number 38 that every fly that flies on the sky, every animal that walks on the earth, illa umamun amsalukum, they are community like you. Scientists in the field, they confirm that animals, they live in community. River Nile, when it makes the Mediterranean Sea, that also, there we find the separation of the sweet water and the sea water. So, like that, you can go on and on the subject of Quran and science, alhamdulillah, and ask question to the atheist, who could have mentioned this, who could have mentioned this. You can speak about embryology. You can speak about the embryology. Minute quantity is used. Semen. And the early stage of the zygote is like a leech-like structure. And this particular thing is mentioned the first time when the Quran is revealed to Prophet Muhammad, اقرأ بسم ربك الذي خلق الإنسان من ألق, created man out of ألق. ألق can be translated as a leech-like structure. ألق can be translated as congealed clotted blood. ألق can be translated something that which clings. All three meanings, alhamdulillah, matches with the early stage of embryo. Dr. Keith Moore, he confirmed that in his book, Developing Human, in his embryology book, he confirmed that and he incorporated these facts and he presented to the world that Quran is confirming with the embryological facts which we know, alhamdulillah, and he agrees with that. So, how could this, could you have mentioned 1400 years ago? He cannot go on and on saying that it can be a fluke. The fingerprint is used. Francis Gold in 1880 says the fingerprint was the method that no two individual being has a equal fingerprint, same to same identical fingerprint. No two individual has an identical fingerprint. Quran mentions in Surah Al-Qiyamah, chapter 75, verse number 3, Ayahsabul Al-Najma Izama, Ayahsabul Insano Al-Najma Izama, does man think that he will not be able to construct your bones? Bala Qadrina Allah, An-Nusawiya Banana. Definitely, nay, he will be able to do that, even your tips of your fingers, An-Nusawiya Banana, even your tips of your finger. So you're talking about the bones, Allah SWT says that even your tips of a finger, which is identical, which is not two are same, even that can be made up, even tips of your finger. Then this particular aspect of the skin, that skin has the pain. Now initially, people understood that brain is responsible for pain. Brain is responsible for pain. Today in this age, embryology and skin, in embryology we come to know that the skin, in physiology we come to know that the skin has pain receptors. And the skin pain receptors are responsible for pain. The burn patient, when he comes to doctor, they check the burn patient with the pin pricking method. If the patient laughs, then doctor cries. If the patient cries with the pin, then doctor laughs. Why? Because if there is a pain, then the doctor knows the pain is not severe, he will survive or she will survive. Pain is not severe, so he is happy. But the patient laughs, oh, there is no pain, so doctor cries. Because burn is severe, even the pain receptors, the down deep burn, it is a deep burn, I have burnt out, and therefore the patient is not feeling pain, so it is a severe pain, severe burn, so patient is difficult to survive. So doctor cries. And I've seen patient, 100% burn patient, they are walking like normal person. They're walking on the street like a normal person. After she is burned completely, she's holding the hand of her relative and walking down the street, talking each other towards the hospital as if nothing has happened. because 100% burn. 100% burn. And that person will not survive. This particular fact was mentioned to Professor Tagata Tagasho of Thailand. The fact from Surah An-Nisa, chapter 4, verse number 56, which says, Inna alladhina kafaru bi ayatina. Those who deny our signs, sawfa nuslihim nara. Soon we will throw them into hellfire. Kullama nazajat juluduhum. As often as the skins are roasted off, baddallahum juludan ghairaha. We will give them another skin so they may taste the penalty. Liyadukul adab. So they may taste them. It says that the pain receptors has, the skin has a pain receptors. So Professor Tagata Tagasho asked, when this was revealed, when this was written down? They said 1400 years ago. He said impossible. It could be 1400 years back. Human can make such a statement. And in one conference, he accepted the Shahada. He accepted Islam and he said, La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasul. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluh. With this, I conclude.
Alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillahi ladhi hadana ila al-iman. وَمَا كُنَّ لِنَهْتَدِيَ لَوْلَا أَنْ هَدَانَ اللَّهِ الْعَزِيزُ الْحَكِيمُ الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ حَمْدًا كَثِيرًا طَيِّبًا مُبَارَكًا فِيهِ رَبِّ شْرَحْ لِي صَدْرِي وَيَسِرْ لِي أَمْرِي وَحْلُ الْأُقْدَةً مِنْ لِسَانِي يَفْقَهُ قَوْلِي أَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ بِسْمِ اللَّهِ الرَّحْمَنِ الرَّحِيمِ يريدون أن يطفئوا نور الله بأفواههم والله متم نوره ولو كره الكافرون رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي Mr. Chairman, the invited guests, brothers and sisters in Islam, and brothers and sisters from other religious denominations, the Jews and the Christians, I welcome you all and I greet you all by the Islamic salutation with its supplication of value saying, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. For those, or to those from the Jewish denomination, I say shalom. My topic today, it's about Christianity and Islam, removing the misconception that people have towards Islam. So today I'm going to touch a little bit on what mostly people from other religious denominations don't understand. Islam means peace. Islam means peace, and Islam means submitting oneself to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's where we get also, Assalamu alaikum means peace be upon you. And if a brother says peace, says Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, it means there is no enmity between me and you. There is no hatred. There is no grudge. There is no envy. There is nothing between me and you. Once someone pronounces Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, it means there is peace between me and you. So, coming back to our topic, I quoted an ayah from the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying, Yuriduna an yutfi'u nur Allahi bi afwahihim. They want to blow out the nur of Allah. They want to extinguish the nur of Allah. They want to eradicate the nur of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala replied in the whole Quran, he said, Wallahu mutimu nurihi walau kalihar mushrikun. Allah will continue burning his nur even if the kuffar dislikes it. Walau kalihal mushrikun, we add and we say, walau kalihal munafikun, walau kalihal mushrikun, walau kalihal. Anyone who doesn't like it, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shall continue burning his nur. When comparing, it's not a matter of comparing as such, but when bringing the truth between Islam and Christianity. Islam is built on five pillars. These five pillars, they did not come once. These five pillars, they came gradually according to the status of Muslims, according to the status of the people at that time. We remember and we know that for the first 13 years of the revelation of the Quran in Mecca, only Muslims, only Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was striving to just change the people from worshipping the idols to the worshipping of Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Prophet would just go and say to a person, La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah, and stop there. For so many years, Prophet, especially for the first 3 years of the revelation of the Quran, Prophet only his mission was to go and say, La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah, and stop there. Later on, when Muslims were increasing and when Muslims were becoming more powerful, and then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would bring another pillar of Islam, that is Salah. And we all know the journey to the seventh heavens. That's when Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was given a gift of Salah. And we all know what happened. Slowly, and then Zakah was made compulsory upon Muslims. Slowly, and then fasting was made compulsory. And then slowly, Hajj was made compulsory. So it means these five pillars of Islam, if you accept the first pillar of Islam, that is Kalima Shahada, La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah, and you happen to miss Salah, that does not affect your faith, although we condemn it in strongest terms. That once you accept Kalima Shahada, La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah, you should follow the other four pillars of Islam. But in case, because we are doing some kind of comparison with our Christian denomination and our Islamic denomination, that when or if it happens by weakness or by any chance you happen to miss one of the pillars of Islam, it does not affect your iman. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Man qala la ilaha illallah dakhala jannah." But you must correct, you must quote me right, and you must understand me very well. I'm just trying to say, if you can't accept the kalima la ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasul, you have become a Muslim. If you happen to miss your salah, if you happen to miss your hajj, if you happen to miss your Ramadan, if you happen not to give zakah, still you remain a Muslim, but we call you a fasik, a sinful Muslim. Now, jumping to our Christian, to our brothers and sisters from the Christian denomination, where we have termed the religion, the Christian religion, a house of cards. Why do we say house of cards? We have pillars in Christianity that are holding the Christian denomination. So if you happen by any chance, happen to remove any card, the whole Christian denomination is what? Is dead. Like we were here yesterday when our brother from the Christian denomination came here. He accepted some of the things that when you accept those things, when you concede those things, we consider you to be a Muslim. All over the Christians, all over the world, they know that when they say Jesus is the Son of God, they really know what it means. They even take him as one of the office bearers in the office of God. And he precisely said, and he clearly said, and I quote, he said, Jesus could not perform any miracle except and until by the will of Allah. That means he puts Jesus in an ordinary form whereby Jesus becomes a servant. I think if other Christians happen to come across this video, if it was recorded, they will come after him. So when we say Christianity, it's a house of cards, we mean that by any means, by any way, by mistake, knowingly or unknowingly, if you happen to take out one, and then you have distorted the whole religion. Whereas our religion, if you accept the kalima la ilaha illallah, and you happen by any chance to miss your salah, you still remain a what? A Muslim. If you happen by wickedness or by peer pressure or by mob psychology because of people around you, you happen to miss one of the pillars of Islam, still you remain a Muslim. We cannot discard you. We can still call you. So we say the difference between Islam and Christianity is the vulnerability of the pillars of these two religions. So Islam, its religions, its pillars are built individually, and when you put them together, you become an excellent Muslim and a very strong Muslim. Whereas Christianity, you have to be very cautious about these things. And wherever you go, and whenever they meet any Muslim or anyone who does not belong to their religion, they are very careful in mentioning and in describing their religion. So we say, Islam is the only way, and we must gather the courage to stand in front of them and pronounce that Islam is the better way. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin.
We start off by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Lord of the worlds. We also praise Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who is the masterpiece of creation. Without him, none of us would have been here today. We also ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless the previous anbiya who came, because they also brought the message of God. We also seek protection from Allah, from the rejected one, Iblis. I greet you, my brothers and sisters, my teacher, and everyone in the room by the Islamic salutation. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. My topic is the end time scenario. I've chosen this topic in light of showing us the three distinctive differences and common attributes of how the signs of Qiyamah will unfold before us. As we know as Muslims, most of the minor signs have been completed. We are currently waiting for the bigger signs. So from the very beginning of creation, we acknowledge and we notice when Iblis disobeyed Allah that there were automatically two forces. The two forces were those who God has purified as his worshippers, and he has granted them his grace. The worshippers of Allah, and there are those who have dedicated their lives to the sinister plans of the rejected one, Iblis. So we can automatically tell you can either be Abdul Shaitan or Abdul Salam in this dunya. So we learn as well that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us that in any age, there will always be people of the good side and people of the bad side. Like in the example of Ramses II, the Pharaoh, and Moses. Moses was a Nabi of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Pharaoh is one of the most arrogant people who have ever walked the face of this earth, who claimed that to be Allah himself. In the case of Muhammad, we can also go there. Muhammad was the prophet of Allah, and you find that he also had an enemy who was the Pharaoh of the time, Abu Jahl. So in our lives, the question should all, we should all also ask the question, who are the Pharaohs of our time? I'll answer this question, inshallah, later in the topic. So my brothers and sisters, we know that the Jews, the Christians, and the Muslims, we all agree that Iblis, or the agent of Iblis, known as the Antichrist Dajjal, will come. And this will be the biggest test to mankind. Who is this Dajjal? Where does he come from is a question to some people. We know as Muslims that one of the companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they were lost in the Arabian Sea, where they came into an island and they met a man. I would just like to describe this man. He's very huge and very tall. He's got maroonish skin. Each teeth has a gap from the other teeth. His hair is like curly blackish. And we learn that this man is one-eyed. So Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us that every prophet has told his people about this Antichrist. But Rasul says, I will tell you something that no other prophet has told you, that he is one-eyed. So amongst us as Muslims, there's a misconception. Some people think that Iblis, the Dajjal himself, has an eye only on his forehead. but this is a misunderstanding from us. It is said that he is blind on his right eye. It's like a bulging grape, meaning he has two eyes, but one eye is actually blind. So we look at from the side of the Christians. What do they say about this character? You read in Revelation 13. They give us a description of a beast that will come from the sea, whose power is from a dragon, and people will worship this beast. And both the Muslims and the Christians and the Jews acknowledge that this beast will have a mark on his forehead. This mark is 666, meaning, or the mark is also interpreted as he will be written Kafir. So who will see that this is Iblis? Because the majority of the people, particularly the Jews, who have rejected Jesus in his first coming, will be the people who will actually say that this person, who is the Dajjal, is actually Isa alayhi salam. And they will describe him as beautiful. I just gave you a description of this guy, a brief description. I don't know how can anyone say that that man is the most beautiful thing they've ever seen. So when Dajjal comes, all the three all three religions, that heavenly religions, the Judaism, Christianity, and Muslims, we all acknowledge that this character will come. So I would like us to go into a bit of details and understand the challenges of the believers and who will be the disbelievers. We understand that those who are true believers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will see the mark on his face, and they will deny that this is the Christ. Those who are not true believers in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are those who will worship him and say he's the most beautiful man, and he will come with miracles. But for us as true Muslims, we are told that this man can only perform a miracle once. If he's challenged in any point, he will not be able to repeat a miracle that he has done before. And it is said that every village he will come, and he will bring torment to those who are mu'minin, those who are true believers in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Moving forward, when Jesus came in the first coming, there was someone known as John the Baptist. He was the one who told the believers of that time that this is the Christ. Similarly, something like will repeat itself. There will be another appointed individual from the family of our Nabi Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam by the name of Muhammad Maida. This is the person that Allah will appoint to prepare us as Muslims. Because as we all know today, there's so much differences within us as well as Muslims. But this is the individual that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has chosen to come and unite the Muslims in preparation for this war that will take place between the bloodlines of the prophets and the bloodlines of Francis II, the pharaohs of today. So similarly, this individual will be the one who will identify Isa in his second coming. But now when you look at it from the Christian point of view, they tell us that when Jesus comes, every eye will see him. Now my question to them is that if I'm here in Durban and Jesus ascends in Syria, is it possible for me to see someone ascending from Syria? To me, there's a misunderstanding from their scriptures. The better understanding is what we Muslims are saying, that similarly, like John identified Jesus, there will also be another character who will identify Jesus. So when Jesus comes, he will prepare us, the mu'minin, for the ultimate battle. And then on the other side, we will find those who are known as the pagan Jews who will be on the side of the Antichrist Dajjal, because they cannot recognize Isa because they could not recognize him in his first coming. So there will be two wars or two sides, the mu'minin and the kafir. So it is said that this will take place in Medina, where Isa will be at that time. And on that Juma Friday, the gates will be opened, where those disbelievers would want to fight the Muslims of that time. May Allah make us or our descendants part of the side of Isa alayhi salam on this time. So when this takes place, the Dajjal, when he sees Isa and when Isa sees him, he will automatically begin to melt. This means that the victory will be granted to the Muslims. And Isa alayhi salam will also have another task to save the Mu'minin from characters known as Majuj and Magog. Now in the Jewish scriptures and in the Christian scriptures, they themselves are jumping here and there about what is actually the Majuj and Magog. Majuj and Magog are a nation. They were here very long ago. They are still here today. But the question is, where are they? We know and we learn that they've been sealed. But on that particular day, when one of them will have a kid by the name of Inshallah, that this seal or this jail that they are currently in will actually open. And they will cause so much harm to the Muslims that we Muslims of that time, together with Isa, we will value a head of a cow more than a million rands. But by the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Isa will make a dua for us. And these horrifying creatures, Majuj and Magog, will die through a worm, through worms that will eat them up. But what will happen as well is that when they are dead, okay, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi. Time was not enough. Jazakallah.
رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي امري واحلل عقده من لساني يفقهوا قولي بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم قل هو الله احد الله الصمد لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا احد. My topic for today, elders, brothers and sisters, it's a oneness of God in major religions. I greet you all by the Islamic greeting, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I chose this topic today because it's something that most of the religions today, they do not notice the oneness of God. Christianity talks about the Holy Ghost, the Son of God, and Jehovah. Now, they do not have a good understanding of oneness of God. So I in this topic, I want to try and make it clear for them so they can understand the oneness of God. Also in other religions, including Hinduism. When we were created at the beginning of time, before we could come on earth, God had created us in a spiritual form. And we were asked to swear that who is your creator? And we agreed that yes, you are our creator and we are going to worship you. But when we came on earth, everything that we were told and that we agree to, God has made it such for us to forget, leaving us here on earth as a test. That's why there's life and there's death, for us to choose from right and from wrong. And there's heaven and there's hell, for us to determine our fate according to our deeds, our good deeds and bad deeds. Looking at nature itself, there is one sun and there is one moon. There is one air that we all breathe and there is one earth. How does all this play. It's logic for us. It's something that we just have to look into nature to realize the oneness of God. Because if they say that there was two gods or there was three gods, like the Hindus say, there should be a lot of conflicts. There should be two suns in the west, four suns in the east, and six suns in the north. But God has made it such that for us to see the nature that he portrayed for us and the logic behind all this is for us to see that there is only one. And in the Hinduism the book, in Bhagavati, it says that there is only one higher power and one almighty. But for them, they see it as everything around them, nature itself, is God. And as Muslims, we see that everything around us, nature, is from God to please us. Christianity has the three cards: the original sin, the divinity of Jesus, and that Jesus died for our sins. Now, if they say that Jesus is God, how could he die for our sins? Because it's Jesus himself on the cross. Before he could go on the cross, he bowed down on his knees and placed his forehead on the ground, pleading to God, to asking God and telling God that he is not ready for this. Meaning that he's asking God to make it easy for him. That alone will tell us that he was not God. He was the servant of God, came down to deliver the message of oneness of God. So we all can follow his teachings and reach that level. Yes, the three original sins. Now coming to Islam, we were chosen. We also got five pillars of Islam. We also got five pillars of Islam. And those pillars of Islam, if you read the kalima, La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah, you are already a Muslim and you're free from all sins. But along the way, if you commit a sin, it's not that you become a kuffar, you become a sinful Muslim. Now to Christianity with the three cards. It's so straight that if they miss out a card, the whole religion collapses and the whole belief and faith collapse. So Christianity is not on the line, because why? There are beliefs that in the Bible, for example, the 10 insects that the Bible speaks about, the Bible speaks about it, but there's no way it says that those things should not be done. The oneness of God, it's something that we should all really look into, because it's there out there for us to see these things. And by us learning comparative religion as a Dai, we can understand and know the basics, how to approach different religions and letting them know the oneness of God and showing them the signs that are there clear for us to see. So, inshallah, I conclude by letting you all know that we should search more and look into it more, that life is one and God is one. So we should search and find out from other religious faith, Islam, that can show us the straight path. Jazakallahu khair. Assalamu alaikum.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I'd like to greet our guest and Dr. Shuaib from all the way from India, and all our brothers who are sharing the same class today. So my topic today is about, is Islam the religion of Arabs and Indians only? So if Islam was the religion of Arabs and Indians only, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam wouldn't have sent all his Sahabas throughout the world. He sent his all Sahabas throughout the world to preach the message of Islam. They even came here in Africa, because Sahabas, they traveled lots. They are even their grave, who were the other Sahabas were buried in Africa, and others were buried in Asia, in Europe, and America. So if this religion was the religion of Arabs and Indians only, Allah, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam wouldn't have appointed Hazrat Bilal radhiallahu anhu to be the first muadhin, the one who gave adhan. So Hazrat Bilal radhiallahu anhu was a slave who was working for Umayyah bin, he was working for Umayyah. So Umayyah was so hard to Hazrat Bilal radhiallahu anhu, so he, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, decided to free Hazrat Bilal radhiallahu anhu, and he freed him from Umayyah. So by the time he wasn't freed, Umayyah used to beat Hazrat Bilal radhiallahu anhu and placed a heavy stone in his chest and says, "Give up Islam, give up Islam." But Bilal never gave up Islam. He used to say, "Allahu Ahad, Allahu Ahad. There's only oneness of God, the only oneness of God." So he never gave up Islam. So he was freed. By the time he was freed, he embraced Islam. After embracing Islam, he was appointed to be the first muadhin of Islam, the one who calls adhan. It shows that this religion is not for only Arabs and Indians only. Coming here to South Africa, in South Africa, this Islamic religion was brought by the Indians. So other black people who has no knowledge, they think that this religion is for Indians only, which is totally wrong. Me, as myself, I used to tell them that this religion is not for Indians only, because it was brought by Indians. That's why you see that this religion is for Indians only. Here in South Africa, I could say that alhamdulillah to all the Indians who brought this Islamic religions in our country. So now we know the truth about Islam. So what is wrong is that the people of South Africa, they believe that this Islam is the religion of Indians only and Arabs only, which is totally wrong. A lot of the Sahabas who were slaves, some of them were blacks in color, which shows that this religion wasn't for Indians and Arabs only. So in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "Al-yawma akmaltu lakum dinukum wa atmamtu alaykum ni'mati." This carries on. So this says that "Al-yawma akmaltu," this religion is for this religion for entire nation. He has completed this religion for every mankind. There's no one will come after Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So if we look by our own knowledge, if he says no one will come after Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it means that this religion is for everyone who is living on earth and who is who's still breathing on earth. And alhamdulillah, the religion teaches us to be pure and teaches us not to be racist and other kinds of religious. But there are those few that say that there are those things that shows that racism will never end. So we know, all of us knows. So I'd like to tell the story of the thieves who were on the journey to steal. These thieves were on the journey to steal. They saw three trees. The first tree was bearing dates, and the other trees was not bearing dates. So there was a bird which was going to this tree and took the dates and feed the blind snake. So this blind snake was being fed by the bird. So they all dropped their swords and cried to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is using this bird to feed the snake, and we are stealing from people to feed our families. So they decided to stop and become good, pious Muslims. So that shows us that this religion wasn't for only the certain kinds of tribe. It was only for all nations. So inshallah, we as Da'is must go and introduce the message of Islam to other religions and to other tribes. Like for instance, here in South Africa, the traditional language is here. They are Zulus. They are Zulu speakers. They have the wrong knowledge, saying that this Islam is for only Indians, because there are no Arabs here in South Africa. They say it's for Indians only, which is totally wrong. So even me at my home, my parents used to beat me a lot and say, "Why are you leaving your traditional? Why are you joining this religion of Indians? The Indians will kill you. They will do this to you, and they will harm you and do this." So by that time, I already knew the story of Hazrat Bilal. That I've already told you, that Allah Ahad, that Bilal was beaten to say, must stop being a Muslim. So at home, me as the only Muslim, so I faced a lot of challenges and a lot of bad, being beaten by the whole family, saying that I must stop Islam. And there's this one time I was watching the ITV channel. ITV channel is where they show the marker, people doing Hajj and performing Salah. And my mother came in and said, "This is my house. You mustn't do these things in my house. You have to go to your own house. If you are living here in my house, you must follow my rules and go by my rules." So I ask her, "Mom, if you don't want me to watch TV, where am I going to watch TV? I'll go to visit my friends, and if I'm visiting my friends, you'll shout at me, say, I mustn't go visit my friends." So that's how it becomes so tough for me. So alhamdulillah, in conclusion, so we as Da'is, we must try our best to introduce the message of Islam to non-Muslims and to other religions that have no knowledge about Islam, and to show them that this is not the religion of one nation, or it's not the religion of one kind of traditional stuff. Alhamdulillah.
Alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillah. Wa salatu wa salam. Ala al-mab'a'uthu rahmatan lil'ameen. وعلى آله ومن والاهم بتحيته وإحسانه إلى يوم الدين. فقد قال الله جل وعلا في القرآن المجيد والفرقان الحميد: ألم نجعل له عينين ولسانا وشفتين وهديناه النجدين. وقال الله سبحانه وتعالى في مقام آخر: إنا أرسلناه بالحق بشيرا ونذيرا ودائيا إلى الله بإذن ربه وسراجا منيرا. وبشر الذين كفروا بأن لهم عذابا أليما. Alhamdulillah, my dear respected brothers. I'd like to greet firstly our guest, who's Dr. Saab, and to conclude the greeting to all the brothers. Now, brothers, when we look to the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, Alam naj'al lahu aynayn, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given this insan two eyes. Alam naj'al lahu aynayn wa lisana wa shafatayn. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given this insan the tongue and two lips. Wa hadaynahu an-najdayn. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given this insan that free of choice, that this insan, so that he can make a difference between the right and the wrong. Now we go to the ayah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Inna arsalnahu bil haqqi bashira wa nadira. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created, Inna arsalnahu bil haqqi bashira wa nadira, that you have sent our beloved Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Bashiran, as a giver of glad tidings, Nadira, as a warner, Wada'iyan ila Allah, and is a caller to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Wasirajan munira, and as a shining lamp, Wabashir alladhina kafaru, and that he should give glad tidings to those who disbelieve, bi anna lahum adaban alima, for them is a painful punishment. And in another ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, Ya'rifunahu kama ya'rifuna abna'ahum. That these unbelievers, they realize Prophet Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam like how they realize their own children. Now, brothers, as you know, this kuffar, we find in their scriptures that the name of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is mentioned in their scriptures. As Isa alayhi salatu wa sallam, he said when Isa alayhi salatu wa sallam told his companions that there will be a prophet that will be coming, which will show the people the straight path. After Isa alayhi salatu wa sallam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took him to the horizon. So that this very Christian, the failing to realize that Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was not only sent by the Arabs, but Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was sent to the entire mankind in order them to take out the mankind from the darkness and to show the mankind the straight path, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at the end of the day will be pleased with them, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will submit them in this garden of Jannah, which is paradise. So as we know, brothers, insan, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given him akal to think, to make a difference between wrong and right. As for those who make a choice to separate, to make a difference between wrong and right, we know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make them happy on that day, which there will be a lot of difficulty. As for those who disbelieve in the coming of our beloved Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then for them it will be misery and punishment at the end of the day. So this insan, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he created insan in the alamul arwah, he say, Alastu bi rabbikum. He asked this insan in the spirit form that, am I Lord your Lord? We all say bala. We all said yes. But when we came to this world, this insan, he transgressed the bounties of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And with arrogance, he's denying the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is one and only. So, brothers, as we know that this effort of this deen that was made by our beloved Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that was a great effort, and it will remain till the day of judgment. But yet these non-believers, they know this deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a correct deen, but they still reject this deen. As we know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said in the Quran, فَمَنْ شَاءَ اتَّخَذَ إِلَىٰ رَبِّهِ سَبِيلًا. So whoever wills, he'll take the path. Whosoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wills, he'll take a correct path. And for those who are misguided, then there is miseries for them on that day. So, brothers, as we know, this deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a great deen, which is the ni'mah, which is the favor that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has bestowed upon us. So, brothers, we should make thanks to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has bestowed this deen on us. And we should try to convey the message to those who are acting arrogance, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said, فَذَكِّرْ فَإِنَّ الذِّكْرَ تَنْفَعُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ, that we should take admonishing, verily admonishment, it benefit the believer. So likewise, if we remind these people of the greatness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and for the message of our beloved Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then at the end of the day, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will save us, will not be amongst those Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will ask us that we have conveyed the message. We find it very hard that in this our days, we still